virtual machine, our base, our main thing which allows us to have fun with small talk.
Sorry, Igor. We need something special with your image because I cannot launch it.
I think. It's cog image. Okay. Sorry. I saved it with cog virtual machine. So this is a lecture, the outline. We will get this is an introductory level for virtual machine, for its implementation. So I will show you a bit about VM Maker internals, how its main classes, its main services. I will explain you about plugins, primitives, object format, and hopefully we could build a virtual machine and build our first plugin at the end of this session. So let's start. So what is a virtual machine? Virtual machine use the image file, which is a snapshot of object memory, and it takes this file as input and can interpret and run it. Virtual machine, Squeak virtual machine runs on multiple platforms. There is a three major platforms: Linux or Unix, Windows, and macOS, which has a flavor of Unix. And there is also ports to different kinds of operating systems, like for embedded devices, Android, iPhone, and many other. So, and this list gets more and more wider. So virtual machine provides you an abstraction layer, basic abstraction layer for platform, so you don't need to deal with platform specific stuff, and you can run your code regardless of what services platform provides or not, of course to some limits, but some basic functionality which VM provides is always you always have on all platforms. So let's go. So virtual machine source code. The virtual machine implemented in Smalltalk. Its main part located at currently is a community-driven project, and it's hosted at Squeak Source under VM Maker project, so you can always watch what happens with this project and see the updates. Also, there is a VM dev mailing list, so if you want to participate in development or ask any questions or anything you need to know about virtual machine, you can join the mailing list and ask questions there. So there's two parts. One part is implementation in Smalltalk, and another part is sources, which is platform specific sources. Initially they are hosted at squeakvm.org, but additionally, and I think it's good move, we place the all the source code at Gitorius. So this is a front end for Git. It's a public repository too, and it allows us to use a less centralized source management control, because initial source code for Squeak VM are using SVN for management, and GitOrius allows us to be more open. So my current tool set, currently working on making the automatic builds for virtual machine, and so tool set is CMake, Git, Firecore 1.3 image is the latest image. I made some changes to make sure it works as I like. The problem is that with ideology of Smalltalk, that it always has a graphical user interface, and it was lacking the functionality when you run the image headless. So I was added the necessary parts to 1.3 image to make sure that during headless mode, when you don't have any, when you don't expect that you have user interaction, there is subroutines which controls this, and if some code expects user interaction, like providing a name or password or whatever, image just produce the error and quit. So you can, when you run image headless in automatic mode, you can detect all these unwanted things and then deal with them. Because because originally, if you run if you just take an image in headless mode and run it in headless mode, it's just hung waiting for user input, and you don't know what happens because you don't see. So that was the problem. Okay, so let's continue. You need to have the Git installed on your PC, and you can load, but I will tell you, give you more precise instructions how to do that, but you can follow this link and check. There is two repositories, one for Coq VM, another for Squeak VM, and we will be working on Coq, but a bit later. And yes, if you how many of you have built the Squeak virtual machine? Can you raise a hand? Okay. So yes, if you have a virtual machine, or if you have the source code on your computer, so you don't need to actually do everything. If you can build VM, you can use OWN, because I will give just introductory examples how to build plugin and things like that. So yes, with GitOrius it's easy to.
Do you want that people do it now, or you just present now and then after they will do it? So you just present now and then after, or you
yes, yes,
everything?
Yes.
Okay.
So it's easy to follow, because, for instance, I find it's very very easy to work, because I don't need to remember all the details. For instance, if I go to register at GitOrius, I can go to the project page and can see what link I should use for cloning, and also if I press asterisk in the edge, it gives me helpful comments for working with repository. So for cloning, you can see it's highlighted. You can just clone, copy and paste the command into your command line and do the clone. That's useful when you don't have to remember all these details Yes. So currently we are in transition. Originally there was QuickVM, and then a couple years before, Elliot Miranda started implementing a new project based on SqueakVM, but it gave a new name, which is COP. And while it's a descendant of Squeak Virtual Machine, so there is right now there is not much different. That's why I can actually what I will show in this lecture, it's applied most of the time to both virtual machines, but of course there is a difference. So COC contains two parts, one built on top of another, on top of other. So stack-based VM is mainly the Squeak VM, which with additional functionality. So it's it uses using the stack for method activations. It means that it maps the native stack to Smalltalk context, and it tries to because of this mapping, it about 1.5 times faster than original Squeak VM, because it maps the Smalltalk context to native context to native stack. And of course it's not visible from language side, so when you need to access the context object, it de-optimizing the context the stack back to context objects. And on top of this implementation, there is a JIT, which is just in time compiler, which producing the native code out of compiled methods bytecode, and it allows you to run even faster, roughly about 3 times faster than original virtual machine. So yes, the main classes of virtual machine is mapped like that. So you have the in original Squeak VM we have object memory, in COC you have new object memory, also interpreter, stack interpreter, and co-interpreter. So whenever I refer to interpreter, it applies both to interpreter and stack interpreter, because today it's almost the same. So but I will use the COC, the stack interpreter and co-interpreter COC for demonstrating the and building VM.
Is it co-interpreter or
co-interpreter? Co. Oh yes, thanks. So yes, let's get started with virtual machine. So VM Maker contains four major parts. It's an actual implementation, which is two classes, object memory and interpreter. Also plugins, which are subclasses of interpreter plugin. Then the layer which responsible for translating this code to C. It's a C code generator class and its subclasses. There is also a front end for automatic generation of all source code and all plugins. It's a VM Maker and VM Maker tool. And there is also interpreter simulator. Yes, and of course you can additionally load the third party plugins to build in the VSV virtual machine. So object memory class. The object memory class main responsibility for object format, memory management, and special objects. The memory management is allocating new objects and deallocating unused ones, which done using a garbage collector. And special objects is an object which is early bound by virtual machine. It means that there's a little convention between language side and virtual machine about specific format of some central objects like classes and some very often used objects like nil, true, false, and some very often used classes like string or array or couple others. So object format, this is just an examples of some methods which object memory implements. So here you see the hash bits of is for this method implements extraction of hash bits from object. So it just goes to the object internals and extracting this data and then returns it to the caller. And another one is testing if object is in young memory region or an old. It's just an example. So this is an example of enumeration of objects in heap. So when you object memory controls the whole heap, it knows which regions are used, which are empty, and so it can walk the whole heap and iterate over objects. So for instance, if you know the method all instances, which is a class, the all instances method is depending on that functionality. So object memory should know about everything and should reach every object in this memory, even if it's not reachable by language itself, even if it's garbage, become garbage. So yes, this is you can browse and see this is a central entry points for object allocation, instantiating new objects. So one is a instantiate class indexable size, and another instantiate small class size in bytes. And for garbage collection, the main entry points is incremental GC and full GC. So incremental is just collecting the young space, and full garbage collection is collecting garbage in everything. Yes. Small class? Don't ask me. I don't know. So I think it's a compact class representation, but we will talk about this later. Yes, and special objects. There is only the object memory organized in such a way that it refers to whole graph of objects through one central object which is known as special objects array, and each for the rest of the objects in system it's accessing them mostly through this special objects array. So for instance, if you see whenever you need to access the array class, it reads the the extract the object from special objects array at index 7, which is class array index. Also, you can see in your image, you can just go to implementation of. So here you can see the array. Yeah, it cannot be printed. Fifty-six indices, and to get more what it's about, you can see this method: recreate special objects array. So remember, the class array was at index 7, but it was because in Smalltalk we have indexes 1 based, and in object memory the indexes is 0 based. So the class array was the class array is 7. And in image you have at 8, you can see that it puts the array class here. So this method fills all the indices of special objects array, and then they are accessed by virtual machine. So this is a central object from which everything, all the knowledge about objects and classes the virtual machine has. So be careful with this object. Okay, interpreter. Originally, interpreter is a subclass of object memory, so it's a like an additional functionality added to object memory to mainly to implement the execution machinery, to implement basic primitives like integer addition or integer other arithmetic operations, floats and object manipulation and things like that. It also provides a public virtual machine IP, which is accessible by plugins and accessible by platform-specific code. Also, it provides the services, which are basic services like input-output, process scheduling. And yes, it's because of all that, because it tries to be all in one, it's quite a huge beast. So a little things about execution machinery. So mainly the interpreter almost 70% of its time spends in the interpreter loop. And if you can see here, the loop is I highlighted as it's infinite loop, which simply takes the bytecode and the bytecode method in bytecode table, and then dispatching jumps to the corresponding entity which handles this bytecode, and yeah, it's done it for forever. So you don't you cannot leave this loop once you enter it. There is no way. So the drawbacks of such implementation that you cannot make a call to interpreter means that, for instance, if you want to use the interpreter as a backend for your application, so you making a call like, please evaluate this message and then give me the answer so I can continue in the host application which use the virtual machine as for scripting, for instance. So you cannot do that, and we need to address that in future. Standard primitives.
Yeah.
Yes?
Stupid question, very stupid. How you can quit the VM if it enters the loop? Is a way to signal it when I get the image? Or
it's just using the operating system function, which just leaves the process.
Bypass the...
Yeah.
By the way, but there is no stupid question.
Yes.
But then the one, if you, this means you use the operating system, so then you discuss with the process and not with the current interpretation. So you, this means that you completely kill the
yes.
Question. So the lines after
yes,
the
exactly.
Loop does not
the
are
after
useless.
The line.
When are they used?
Yes.
Yes, you know, in C there is a special break break state control flow statement which could break out of the loop, and of course if you translate this method to C, you can explicitly return from it from at any point. So there is a way to leave the interpreter, but yes, but it's designed without this in mind. I mean that it's mainly designed as an infinite loop. So standard primitives, as I said, it includes the core functionality of virtual machine, the integer operations, float operations, object creation and manipulation, the process scheduling, controlling the garbage collector, and the basic things like saving your image and creating from interpreter loop. So here's an example of primitive new, which allocates a new fixed size instance. It's every time you invoking a new message to send a new message to some class, it's end up in this primitive. So about what it's doing inside, I will talk in detail later. Right now it's just an example. Yes, also a public virtual machine IP. So there is a so-called interpreter proxy, which is a canonical way to access the VM virtual machine functionality. It means that you usually don't have virtual machine are not open for everything, and it's the interpreter proxy. Actually, the set of functions which you can use outside of virtual machine, like in plugins or in your C code, which could be in platform specific code, but mainly it's done of course for plugins. You can look the whole protocol of interpreter proxy. You can just look at an image. Oh. Hmm? Okay. So you see there's a lot of different functions, and this actually just stops for simulator, but when you translate in when it translates to C code, it actually turns to direct calls to virtual machine functions, which located either in object memory class or interpreter class. So it's just a set of public interface which is standard for use outside of virtual machine. So we could have some proper encapsulation. Yes, there's also an exceptions when some methods are not included into interpreter proxy, but still used by some C code inside of platform specific code, and to make sure that they are exported and visible by these functions. They are marked by special API pragma. So I can show you. So like something like this. It means mainly it means that code generator during analyzing the code, it ensures that you have the function definition for this method, and because if method isn't used only by some one method and used only once, it just fully inlines that code and it not generates the corresponding C function for this method. Yes, basic input-output. So, since originally Smalltalk virtual machine was like an operating system, so it was fully, it should fully support all the interactions starting from keyboard input, file input-output, and ending with display and mouse and other things like sound and graphics. So interpreter I think that if you could see it from perspective of 80s, it implements the whole operating system, but from perspective of our modern age, is of course not everything which you would like to have from operating system. It's just the basic input output. But from perspective of 30 years before, it was like whole operating system implemented in virtual machine. So virtual machine is huge beast. Just some metrics, some statistics. So 580 methods in interpreter class and 274 in object memory. So totally it's about 1,000 methods. Of course not every method you need to know about it, because most of the times you just refer to the interpreter proxy, which is a public IP, and the rest is only for hackers who want to change the virtual machine in some way. Yes, it contains a lot of state, so you can without the proper tools, without browser, without good code navigation, you can lost that. And still, it's much better than using C. So because if you look the generated code which produces the code generator, the main body of interpreter, it's about it's more than 1 megabyte of C code. So if virtual machine will be written fully in C instead of Smalltalk, you can be lost forever there. It's unmanageable. It's too complex. Yes, but we aren't, because it's implemented in Smalltalk, and we can use the browser and refactoring browser, and we can quickly navigate and find the way to needed functionality. So this section will be about object format, how objects internally persistent in memory and how to access them. So what is object pointer? Object pointer is machine word. So for 32-bit system is a 32-bit value, and for 64-bits correspondingly is 64-bits value. So here the object pointer for 32-bits system. It's not usually in C world you have pointer and it points to some memory location, but in virtual machine we have special tagged pointers. The lowest bit of object pointer are reserved to indicate if this pointer is an immediate value. So instead of pointing to some memory location, the object pointer itself carrying the value, and we use it for small integer instances. So every object pointer which has lowest bit set, the rest of the bits contains a 31-bit signed integer value. And if this bit is not set, then the whole object point, the whole word is a pointer to some memory location. And this actually quite nice, because it could be seen that we losing the address space, because for 32 bits you could have the 2^32 different addresses, but in reality we have all the objects are aligned in memory. So this means that the pointer to the object always even. So every pointer always have its bit lowest bit set to zero. Yes.
Mariano, what was the problem that you got? Because you know when they told you that you are an idiot.
Yeah. No.
Like that.
One of the things that we were discussing, if since the first bit already, the second bit is also zero. If there was a way to encode another immediate offset there.
Yes. There was, but I just show you.
My question was more, you know, what was the problem that you got? Because I think that it was a mistake that everybody would do just because.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. I'm trying to remember.
Was not a complement to 2 and things like that.
So you see that So all object pointers which are properly aligned, they always have the lowest bit 0. This means that it not matters It means that you can reserve the bits for small integers without losing the address space.
Can you explain the expression?
This one? Yes, suppose that this is various object pointers. And they constructed in object memory in that way that they are always even. So you don't have the like 1 or 7. And that's why you can use the lowest bit for tagging object and marking it as an immediate small integer value without losing the address space. Because your address space is properly aligned.
When they decided to use the first bit small integer, etc., I guess they were not stupid. So they used another way of aligning the because otherwise why they would use the same bit if it would be already been zero?
Yes, there is
a different alignment strategy, something like that.
Yes, there is. I think there is other virtual machine. I don't know which one, which using the zero tagged small integers. So it means that it's reversed. That if the lowest bit of object pointer is zero, then it's a small integer, and the benefit of that you have less operations for small integer arithmetics, because you don't need to clear the lowest bit before adding two small integers and things like that, or multiplying them. Yes, but from other side, it means that you need to access the object pointers. You have to always take in account that you don't access it directly, but you need to shift by one bit, because then you have tagged object pointers, because all object pointers has a zero bit, lowest bit is set to one, and you have to take that into account when accessing the memory. The thing is that it's trade-offs, because for modern CPUs you have the best performance when you accessing memory with aligned pointers, when you have lowest bits aligned to the machine word size. This is 32 bits on 32 bit system. So here's the object header. This is a 32 bit word describing the basic structure of object which held in the object memory. This is you don't have to remember that precisely and remember the layout. I just mark for you just to show what it contains, and as you see you have the method names which you can use for accessing the these bits. So the parts: garbage collector bits. So when you of course for introduction level you don't have to deal with that, but there are 3 bits reserved for garbage collection. When garbage collection walks the object graph, it marks the objects with the mark bit, and there is corresponding method for this is which is located in object memory class, which named is marked. Then compact class index. There is a special set of classes which are encoded by its name, like compact. It means that mainly it means that there is a 32 different classes which encoded directly in header. So in special objects array, which I talked before, you have 32 bit array, one of the indices of special objects array, which points to the list of these compact classes. So each class which put there, the instances of that class having the an indirect reference to this class through the compact class index. And because of this, the instance could reside less memory space than usual object. But I will talk in detail about this a bit later. I have extra slide for that. Yeah.
Maybe we speak about later. But so the normal object, they have an extra.
Yes, they have the extra pointer to its class.
So we
and
get in memory.
Yes.
We have fewer memory for their instances.
Yeah, for complex, there's the most widely used objects like array and compiled method and some other.
But then when retrieving the class, it's slower because there is a level of indirection.
Yes. It's actually, it's.
Because you don't have a word for the class pointer.
It's always a trade-off between speed and memory. So if you want to have faster access, if you have to get rid of this. So your logic of retrieving the class of object will be simpler.
This would explain why in the early, if you look at pretty old code,
yes,
in Smalltalk, they use a lot of arrays rather than using classes,
yes,
to explain things, which makes the code really hard to follow at times if you're looking at old stuff.
But yes, but this makes more compact the usage of memory. Yes, and also the header contains an information about object size, which is the number of machine words reserved for in object memory for this object. So you can use size bits of to extract this header info from object header, and also there is a hash bits, and so you see there are 12 bits, which is from 28 to 17, 12 bits which having which storing the integer value around a random hash. The identity hash, you should know what is it. I think you know what it used in collections like identity set or identity dictionary. And mainly it's just for hashing the objects by some integer value. Again, format of the object. There is a totally the four bits denoting 16 possible object formats, but there is not 16. There's a bit less, but this is the 4 bits is reserved in header for object format. And header type denotes the number, actually the number of full machine words reserved for header. So in for compact classes, it's almost always the one, which is means that object contains only header, only one word reserved, and for other headers, there are three kinds. One is a just object header. Another is object header plus pointer to the class, and third one is three words, which contain size, class, and object header. Yes. So, as you can see, the three header types. Header type zero, is for when size, object size, cannot be encoded in the base header, which don't fit to the size bit of to the object size field, so it creates a populate the header with three words in following layout. So you have first comes the size word, then class pointer, and then header. For header type 1, you have the header and class pointer, and header type 3 is a for compact classes, you have only header word and then some object slots. So for instance, for if you create the object which has no state, like object or true or false, they have only header, so they're residing on only one word in object memory. Of course, if they are compact, if they are not compact, then they take in the two words in object memory. Collection classes? It depends. There is a collections which like array. It's a collection, but it's in special objects array. So it it could have either just header or header size and class pointer. So the thing is that it's like a trade-off between size and space, and it will be good to design, because this layout is 30 yeah. years old, and it will be good to take in account or modern architectures and design the object header which fits best for our current era. So maybe at some day we will address that and change this format. It's unused. Yes, actually it's used for tagging that memory region taken by object is free. That means that for heap management, it's marking the free memory region. Yes, in Smalltalk you have two kind of fields, fixed slots. Yes.
You mentioned that there was padding, well, that every object was aligned.
Yes.
So I was wondering, for example, variable byte classes, is there padding at the end of an object?
Yeah, there is a padding, so all the objects are padded properly, so even if you have like...
The alignment depends on the VM or the platform, or how do you determine the alignment?
On VM. It always aligns all when it allocates the memory in heap. When it formats the space for object, it always takes a aligned number of bytes from heap reserves for object, and it knows how to deal with that. Even if your object size is not aligned in memory, it's still in heap, I mean, it's still aligned.
But aligned to what size? Is it
to
size different?
To 32 bits, I think. Okay. Even in 64. But maybe, it depends. I never deal with 64-bit virtual machine, so I cannot tell precisely. But I think it's too low level detail for this. Yeah, so object format, we have two kinds of slots. As you can see, when you use an instance variable, they correspond to fixed fields or fixed slots. And for variable sized objects, when you creating the object by specifying the number of fields, this creates it using the indexable fields. So for instance, when you create an array with 50 elements, there is a special primitive which accessing these fields, basic add and basic add put. Or you can of course create your own variable subclass, and it still should use the same primitives for accessing the indexable slots. For instance variables, they are accessed using bytecode, so bytecode having you have the bytecodes for retrieving or setting instance variable in object. Yeah, so object format. So as you can see, there is 9 or 10 different object formats. So first is a object without any fields. It's like which we use for nil, for true, false, or other singletons, or just for objects which contain no state. The one is which contains only fixed fields. Another which just for indexable fields. So you see, from 0 to 4 it's just to 3 is just a various combination of fixed and indexable fields. The fourth is reserved for a weak reference type. So you if you know that there is a special class which a weak array, it has the indexed fields weakly. It means that during garbage collection, the object memory don't walk these fields during mark phase, and if object become garbage, it fills these slots with nils. Okay, and yes, there's a indexable word and indexable long. It means that the field is either 32-bit value or 64-bit value, and the basic at put primitives could be used to access them. Also for byte, which you know the byte array. And the extra format types is reserved for compiled method. But I will talk a bit detailed about compiled method later. So structure navigation is a basic method for navigating the object and extracting the information about its fields and it's knowing its format and slots. So here you have to the right you have the instance of point. It contains 4 words, header class, and 2 slots for its x and y value. For accessing in a virtual machine code, you use the fetch pointer of object. So the first argument is the pointer index, it's 0 based, and another is the object which you use for fetching the value. So I can show you if you want, I can show you by examples of who using this method of usages of this method. So as you can see, it's used quite often, 350 usages, and it's all about fetching some fixed slot from object pointer. Of course, when you're using this code, you should know. You should validate that your object contains the required number of slots. I mean that in this example, the point op should have at least one fixed slot. Otherwise, you will access some random value, and so you have to validate that the object you use have at least one fixed slot. And of course you shall you should refer to the object format and to make sure that you are not accessing outside of object, because you can always make mistakes like that because it's low level code. Yes, and for storing you have the corresponding store pointer of object with value, so it stores the at given index it stores the pointer with some specific value. One of the important things about this that during the store there is a write check, so if you storing the pointer to object could trigger garbage collection, just for you to know, storing the pointer. So fetching object class, there is a special method for fetching class, it's implemented by object memory. Point? I don't. Let's check. Yes, in this case, it just contains the header.
Index is compact.
Yeah, it's compact. Yeah. So, wrong example. Yes. Yes. So if it's, but you can see if you of course see that it checks that it takes the object header and the compact class of or op. So if it's non-zero then it takes the class of object pointer and look up the compact class instead of loading the class word which is prepending the header.
So what could the index method
index? It transfers the index of compact class in the special compact classes array. Which also an index in special objects array. For indexed variable access, there is a tree, or there's three different kinds three different basic functionality. You have to check if this object is indexable. You have methods like isBytes, isWords, and so on. Also, you have to extract the size of the object. So you see, you can see here, it uses byte size of method. And then for accessing the first field of this object, it uses the first indexable field. So you get in the pointer to the first field of the object, and then you need to access at some index, you have to increment that pointer by some value. So yes, is bytes, check that object format is variable bytes. For classes like byte string, byte array, it transfers true. For all classes which are variable byte subclass. There's, of course, object memory and the interpreter having special knowledge about some specific classes. For instance, for class, it contains, it reserves the three first fields for superclass, message dictionary, and instance specification. So it means that you are not allowed in image in your language side, you are not allowed to change this, or I mean you cannot rearrange these fields, otherwise virtual machine won't understand your class anymore, and you won't be able to use this object as a class from point of view of virtual machine. It means that you have you have to fulfill this contract with virtual machine, otherwise it will not work. And there is a number of contracts with virtual machine. So overall structure. So if you have the point like 10 and a big number, so you have point with two fields, x is a small integer, y is large positive integer, and the layout in object memory is like following. So the class of the point refers to its class, and the x slot refers to the small integer, so it's not a pointer, it's just immediate value which stored directly in the slot of the point. And y is a pointer to instance of large positive integer. And as you can see, all the object pointers always point to the header word. So no matter what format of object, it always points to header. So in that way, virtual machine can always figure out how to access the object and its format and things like that. A compiled method is a special object format which, in addition to object header, having additional word which is a method header. Also, it contains a variable sized object pointer slot which is known as literals frame, and then the rest of the compiled method is treated as byte. Is byte values, the variable sized, also variable sized. So here's a description of compiled method header. So mainly it contains the information for primitive number of literals, number of temporary variables, and number of arguments. This information is needed for virtual machine to know when it activates the context for given method, to know how much space to reserve on stack, or which kind of context it requires for activating. And also the primitive index is used to mark the compiled method that it's using primitive. If it's zero, then it's usual method, and if primitive number is non-zero, then virtual machine look up the primitive in primitive table and tries to invoke this primitive.
Methods have different header than other objects.
So you see the object header on top, this is a usual header word.
Okay.
And then immediately after it, the following four bytes is reserved for method header. And then you have, depending of information encoded in method header, you have the literals, and the rest is bytes. So to calculate the whole size of object is still using the header, because it's like superset of usual object format. But to calculate the literals, it using the method header, because the information how many literals it contains residing only in method header. So for garbage collection, when you need to walk all the object references, it reads the method header. Yes, so you can in image you can check the literals. So here, for instance, point corner, you have four different literals, and in virtual machine you have the special methods for this: literal count of, literal of method, and you also have the primitives which accessing the literals of compiled method, which is primitive object add and primitive object output. So few words about bytecode. Bytecode is just a compact set of instructions which interpreted by virtual machine. So from abstract point of view, you can see the bytecode is just a primitive operation. So you can decompose the bytecode to the set of primitives. So you can imagine that you have, for each bytecode, you have a separate method which has this primitive number set to the corresponding unique number. So bytecode operations can be grouped basically to stack manipulation, message sending, state access like instance variable access and temporary or argument access, then special bytecodes for closure management, for activating the block closures, and for returning from methods and from closures. So if you need to look up which bytecode means to which operations a specific bytecode corresponds, you have to look up in the initialized bytecode table. So I can show you. So for instance, you see here the 17 and 18. Oh, maybe we could take the bigger method so we can. So you see this is a four byte. This method contains four byte codes, and now we can look if it's so bytecode 21, it's in a range between this number and this. So this push temporary variable bytecode. So if you want to know how this bytecode implemented, what operations corresponds to this bytecode? Ah, yeah, maybe. Ah, yes, yes. This number corresponds to the instruction pointer, And this is a actual bytecode, but it's encoded in hex, so we should.
Do you know why it's encoded in hexa? Because in the interpreter it's.
It just printed here like that. So,
yes,
so it's 65.
It's very useful because in the interpreter it's with decimal. So I have to do all the time that.
Yeah, you have.
We should change the view.
So this is push literal variable. Yes, so you can see the implementation of this bytecode, which takes the current bytecode and doing bit end, so we can take 65 bit end. So it's literal at index 1, and then if we follow to this method, we can see that it's. We can see that it's takes the literal, extracts the literal from the method at given index and push into stack. So this is a central method for referring the correspondence between bytecode value and its implementation in interpreter. So you can see here all the bytecodes, all possible bytecodes. Yes, we finished this section. Your questions.
So when you got ranges for the bytecode, like for example the last one, that you have a range.
Yes.
Bytecode.
It means that bytecode includes some bits in bytecode includes the additional information which reused. I can show you.
To go.
You see, Mariano, like that the.
So you see push receiver variable, if you look at it. It uses the current bytecode, which lies in range from 0 to 15, and it takes the last 4 bits of it and use it as index for receiver variable index. So whenever you see here a range, it means that part of bytecode is reused for encoding the operation like index or.
And the numbers on the left are the structure pointer.
Yes. Is this?
Yes.
This? Okay, I can show you. It means that compiled method is originally it behaves like a byte array, so it's like variable byte object, but it reserves the first words depending on the method header for object pointers. So you need to know at which index. If you look at compiled method as byte array, yes. So at which index you have the first bytecode? So for this method, for instance, you have the 21th byte as the first instruction in this array. So you can see. So you see the initial PC initial instruction index for this method is 21. It means that the 20 bytes above is reserved for literals. So in 20 bytes you can fit the method header and four literals, which means that four multiplied by 5 is 20, and plus 1 is first is first byte code of method of compartment. So yes, here you see if you in literal frame you add the four literals, each is four bytes long, then first byte code will be at offset of 21. More questions?
I have a question about we see the range of the bytecode. We see the range of the bytecode, for example, push receiver variable, it's 0 to 5.
Yes.
But for example, interpreter much more than 15.
For most often use, it's there have an optimal case, and there is a different bytecode for pushing the variable with index more than 15. Yes, and there is also same for literals. So if you have more than 16 literals in method, so you have special bytecode for a longer form. But for most often you have, when you have short methods and it fits into the 15, or usually you don't, if you write the code properly, you don't have the objects which more than 15 instance variables, otherwise it sucks. Okay. So more questions?
Just another remark on your other slide where you used the point, which is a compact class.
Yeah.
The large positive integer is a compact class too, but it's a variable class. So maybe this is the missing type two you were looking for.
The point is that when you have the size, the sizing header, it cannot represent it with different format. So even if your object is compact, it uses the same layout.
Okay, but why is it in the compact array thingy there?
Because if size field fits in the, if you can encode the size in the object header, then you don't need extra size field in the object format. So here you see the object size is bits from 2 to 7 is 6 bits. So if your object size fits in this 6 bits, then you don't need the extra size field. Okay, no questions? Okay, I will continue after a little break. Yes? Just how the nature calls. Thank you.